Hi, everyone. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving this opportunity to present my work here. Today I'm going to talk about the quintuplet minimal dark matter in left-right symmetric model. This is a work in progress, so we're still working on it, so the results are preliminary, but they should all be okay. So this is a very brief outline of my talk. First, I'm going to tell you very briefly about some features of left-right symmetric models. Then I'm going to move on to this quintuplet LR model, which is the topic of this talk. Then I'll tell you the about the dark matter candidate in this model. And then I'll tell you about the phenomenology of a heavy scalar that is there in the model. And finally, I'll conclude. So left-right symmetric models are very well made, motivated, and they are very popular these days. They are basically extended gauge groups of the standard model with this SU3 color cross SU2R cross SU2L cross U1B minus L. So instead of U1Y, you have this SU2R cross U1B minus L, which at some scale breaks into U1Y to give you the standard model. Now, since I have SU2R and SU2L, all my quarks and leptons are now doublets instead of singular right-handed quarks and leptons as in the standard model. Now, a few of the features of LR models is that it can, first of all, it can explain the origin of parity violation as a spontaneously broken symmetry rather than it being explicitly broken. Second, it can solve the strong CP problem. And in the minimal scenario, we can easily generate a light neutrino mass without introducing any heavy fermions or anything into the model. So now, let me talk about this quintuplet LR model. So as I told you before, all my quarks and leptons are now doublets. So I have this left-handed doublet, right-handed doublet, similarly left-handed lepton doublet, and right-handed lepton doublet. See, I have this right-handed neutrino built into the model, so I don't have to put it by hand. But this right-handed neutrino can get a heavy mass if I have a triplet in my scalar spectrum, which I don't have here. So since I don't have the triplet, I cannot generate my light neutrino mass without introducing any extra fermions. So I need this extra singlet fermion, which will now help me to generate the light neutrino mass by inverse seesaw mechanism. So that's why I need this extra singlet fermion N. My dark matter here, what we have considered is a five-plet of SU2R. So it has five fields. So here I've chosen the B minus L to be four. It can be four, two, or zero. But I've chosen it four because I'm getting this high charge states, which can give you interesting collider signatures as well. And my scalar sector now consists of a doublet Higgs. This is my right-handed doublet, and it has this neutral field, which when gets a non-zero vacuum expectation value, can break my right-handed symmetry. I have this bi-doublet phi, where this two neutral fields, when they get again non-zero waves, they will break electric symmetry and generate quark and lepton masses and CKM mixing. And I have the singlet S, which gives mass to this chi field, and it also helps in getting a low mass dark matter for the correct relic density. So I've explained all this. So now all the non-zero vacuum values in this model are given here. So phi 1 and phi 2, which were the bi-doublet neutral fields, are getting wave, which we call V1 and V2. HR0 gets a wave of VR, and the singlet S gets a wave of VS. A symmetry breaking pattern is this one. So when I give wave to this HR, this SU2R cross U1B minus L breaks into U1Y. And then when I give wave to V1 and V2, I finally get U1 electromagnetic. The Yukawa Lagrangian is given here. See, the first two terms, this YQ and YQ tilde, are responsible for the up and down type quark masses. And this YL and YL tilde give mass to the charged leptons. Plus, they also generate some off-diagonal terms in my neutrino mass matrix. And these two terms are essential for the neutrino mass. I haven't written the neutrino mass matrix here, but it will be a 3x3 matrix where I can get the light neutrino mass by inverse seesaw. Okay, so these are my gauge bosons that are there in the theory, the heavy ones. The light ones are exactly the same as in standard model, so I haven't written them down. This MWR and MZR are the heavy gauge bosons that are there. See, both of their masses are proportional to this heavy, like right-handed symmetry weighting scale. And what is interesting here is because I have doublets, this MZR over MWR is of the order of 1.2. Here I've taken GL is equal to GR. So this GR is same as the like left-handed cage coupling. My scalar potential is given here for completeness. The only term that would be interesting for this talk is this alpha 3 mu 3 times the scalar times phi dagger phi, because this will give you the mixing of the standard model Higgs particle with this heavy Higgs, which S will mix with this phi and give you the heavy Higgs. But we will take this mixing to be small. So effectively, the heavy Higgs is kind of singlet-like. Okay, so now let's talk about the dark matter in this model. The like neutral component of this chi quintuplet that I had is my dark matter candidate. Now, it is interesting because I have taken a quintuplet, so I don't need to introduce an extra symmetry to actually stabilize the dark matter. All the terms that can lead to dark matter decay are either dimension 6 or higher. So at the universe time scale, my dark matter would be stable by itself. I don't need to put in any extra symmetry by hand. And this charge, like fields of the sky, would produce a very interesting collider signatures, which like, will be discussed in the next talk by Nilanjana. The mass term for the dark matter comes from its coupling with the singlet field. So it's this lambda chi times S chi bar chi. So when S gets a non-zero wave, the lambda chi times S will give the mass for the all the fields. But the thing is that since this is one single term, so you see all these chi fields, the five of them, are getting a mass which are a degenerate. But that's not a problem because that the degeneracy is actually lifted at the one loop level through this W and Z and photon loops, like running into the loop. And this is a plot of this mass differences as a function of the dark matter mass. So on the x-axis, we have the dark matter mass. And this chi plus is actually not the mass of the chi plus, but it's the mass difference of chi plus with chi zero. Like similarly for chi 2, chi 3, chi 4. So these are all the mass differences. So like whatever my dark matter mass is here, which is the chi 0, plus this thing will give you the chi plus mass, plus this thing will give you the chi 2 plus mass, and similarly. Okay, so now let's talk about the relic density for the dark matter. The couplings that are essential for calculation of the relic density are this chi couplings with the gauge bosons and the heavy singlet scalar, and the heavy singlet scalar coupling with the standard model like Higgs. So this is the alpha 3 mu 3 coupling that I was talking about. Then there's this lambda chi coupling, and these are the couplings of the chi with the gauge bosons. So this is my relic density plot as a function of the dark matter mass, and this is the 0.12 line, which is the observed relic density. And we see that there are two or three points like at small mass of chi zero, which satisfies my relic density bounds. And we see there are three kinks here. These kinks can be easily understood because these correspond to the annihilation or co-annihilation channel of the dark matter. See, I took this heavy scale, like singlet mass to be 1 TeV. So this first kink is at 500 GeV, which is half of this heavy singlet mass. And this corresponds to the annihilation of the dark matter into through this H1 into two Higgses or whatever standard model final states. This one is the co-annihilation of the dark matter with its next charge thing, so chi zero with chi plus, through a WR, and this one is dark matter annihilation again through ZR. So that's why they're at this scale. So now let me talk about the phenomenology of the heavy scalar that I have in the model. So an interesting mechanism that happens here is the like production of the heavy scalar is through photon fusion. Now, the parton density of the photon in the proton is well known, especially like recently there has been quite a lot of interest in it. So this photon coming from the proton through this chi charge particle loop can give me the heavy singlet scalar. And similarly, this heavy singlet scalar can now decay through the same loop into two photons, giving a diphoton excess. These are the various decay channels for this heavy scalar H1. So it can go into HH, gamma gamma, Z gamma, ZZ, and this two chi fields also. So chi plus chi minus or chi 2 plus chi 2 minus, chi 0, and this is a plot of the branching ratio. So you see that at the low mass, when the chi threshold has not yet reached, like 2 times m chi has not been reached, Higgs is the main decay channel. So my heavy Higgs will go into 2 light Higgses, and there is a small gamma-gamma thing here. And then once this threshold opens up, most of the decay is into this chi fields. But this gamma-gamma doesn't have to be very small. It can be quite substantial, depending on this alpha 3 and this lambda chi coupling. So in the next plot, see, if I take, in the previous one, see, alpha 3 was 0.5. I took mu 3 to be electric wave, and I took lambda chi to be 0.5. In the next one, when I take alpha 3 to be 0.1 and lambda chi to be 1, see, this gamma-gamma at this point, around 700 GeV, is almost 35% to 40%. So it has quite an enhanced. So this can be an interesting signal for these kind of models if they're actually realized in nature. And this gamma-gamma can also give you this chi 4 plus, chi 3 plus pairs. So that can give you like multitude of multi-lepton final states. So with this, I come to the conclusion of my talk. So what we have done here is we have studied a minimal dark matter model in LR scenario with a quintuplet dark matter. It's stable by itself. We don't need to introduce any extra symmetries. This extra singlet dark matter helps, this extra singlet that I introduced here helps in getting the dark matter mass and also in getting its correct relic density at low dark matter masses. And it has unique collider signatures which may be studied. Thank you.
For this talk, so any questions?
Yeah, it depends on what value of lambda chi you're choosing. If you choose a high value of lambda chi, yeah, it will.
Something depends. Sir, at the running, because of SU2 dimension, it will hit the lambda pole so soon.
Which coupling would hit the lambda pole?
SU12 coupling.
Okay, I have to see at what scale it will hit the lambda pole. But I don't think it will be, it shouldn't be something below 10 to the 4 or 10 to the 5 GeV, at least.
Okay, you may.
Yeah, I have to calculate, I don't know. Number.
Any other questions? So your dark matter is a decaying dark matter, right?
Because it has dimension 6 couplings
can it decay in final states involving photons?
The dark matter, it can decay if you write dimension 6 couplings. At the universe time scale, it is stable.
So you said that lifetime is larger than
age of the universe. Depends on what you choose for this M. Like, it's a dimension 6 coupling.
Photon, then you can have constants from the
photon
background.
I don't think it can decay into just photons. Okay. It will have some other fermion.
No, but if there is a photon in the final state.
Yeah, so then with that can be.
Any other questions? Okay, if not, let us thank Ayon once again.